depression or grief for the greater good, to learn from what you do in a bad place, to promote your work for grief, learn how to cope, meet counselors and people who've been in your place, meet a new friend, and learn what journey and purpose your life is. So before we actually get into discussion and talk, I'm just going to give you a little bit of background about why I started my foundation, and then Kamisha will also do the same, and then we'll kind of go from there. So I wrote mine, as most of you probably know, I love to write, and I'm very anal about certain things that and how I say them, so I'm just going to read to you this, and everything else will be, you know, just spoken. I started this foundation after realizing that after years of trying to be strong for other people, I was still grieving loss. Loss of friends, loss of family, and other loved ones. I have a lot of businesses, but none of them were fulfilling, and I felt lost inside. I kept searching for something with more meaning and purpose. Then one day, after a meditation retreat, I decided that I would put meaning into my life and other people's lives by starting the Stacy Jewel Foundation. In 2013, my husband was killed. In 2019, my brother was killed. In March of 2023, my older sister passed away from ovarian cancer. In 2023, my aunt of mine passed away on my mother's side from cancer. And without sounding hardened, there will be many people to pass as I get older. So I'm trying to figure out a way that I can actually use grief to help other people. And that was where my mind was at the time. In the process of learning myself, I learned that many others are feeling the same way that I do. Therefore, the Stacy Foundation was born. Some days you can be having a great day, other days you can be having horrible days. One thing about me that people do not know is that when I am actually really, really, really cheery and really, really, really happy, a lot of that comes from me suppressing some of my grief and depression. So don't always assume that because somebody is happy around you that they're not feeling anything. You know, sometimes they put on a face for the world, and then they have to go behind closed doors and deal with all of those things that they have been dealing with for years. And one of the biggest things I always try to tell people is that there is no time limit to grieve. There is no, there is no time limit to grieve. There is no, this person has been gone for 4 years, get over it. Everybody's healing process is different. And there are stages, and those stages can revert. You can be at the last stage, you're getting ready to feel like, okay, I've got to overcome, and something can trigger you to go back. So don't ever feel like you're a failure or things aren't working for you. One of the reasons that we decided to kind of work on this is to give you options and to give you ways to think of outside the box that we've dealt with before. And obviously, a connection. We want to connect with people. We want to get you in the same room as us. We want to network. We want to be able to focus on what we need and what you need to get past this, but also to help other people. So that's the biggest thing, seeing other people to be able to succeed through grief is so empowering, and I love it. It's something that I thrive on, to be honest with you. So one of my things that I wanted to do is talk about life after death and why it is important. You are still here for a reason. You are here to do things, whether you believe it or not. The smallest thing, helping somebody with a grocery bag, or telling somebody that they look amazing, or the little things you do make a big difference in somebody's life. I actually worked at a job where I used to tell this girl that her hair was cute every time she did something different to it. And one day she came to me and she said, you know, I really appreciate your comments. And I said, well, it looks amazing. And she said, you know, no one else ever comments me on my hair in my appearance. And it really made her feel like she was important. Just that gesture. I didn't have to buy anything or pay her anything. I just genuinely gave her a compliment. And so one of the things that I feel is important every day is to kind of advance somebody else's life in any way possible, whether it's a compliment, helping them with counseling, talking to them about grief, doing a conference. And I really feel like that is important. So I wanted to ask Misha, because she's also been through some situations, what is one of your biggest ways of helping somebody else in a way that helps you?
I would say just explaining to them that life after death, it does get better. Even though, and I know it sounds so crazy, so if you're just starting your spiritual journey, I know, just trust me, if somebody would have told me that days after my son passed away, I would have been like, there is no way how I feel like I feel right now that this is ever going to get better. I am 9 years in, just a few days ago on the 7th, which is the day my son passed away. And I can say that even though I dealt with my waves of grief during that process, during that time frame, that it wasn't as bad as it was when it first happened. Does it still feel the same? Absolutely. But in my early days, I could not stop crying. I really just could not come out of that darkness that where we sink into after we lose someone close to us. But every day, honestly, that I could get up one moment at a time, 1 second at a time, is what I took. And that's what it takes. It just takes you being brave in that moment. It takes you just saying, I can do this, and I can do this for my loved one. I can get up and try to push past today because I know they would want me to. So when I help other people, I honestly cannot say this enough. I really get healing when I help somebody else in that process, in that time frame, right from that beginning moment, because I understand, she understands what it is they're going through. So I might got off that question. It will get easier.
grief and how we use that to do good. So I know it sounds like a repeated thing, but in depth, one of the things that I feel helps other people is putting their time and interest into something and someone else. So as a part of that, when I created the Stacy Jewel Foundation, I wanted to make sure people got counseling. I wanted to make sure I put on conferences so that like-minded people can get together and people who are afraid to actually open up to other people. Sometimes it's hard to open up to people that you know, only because you may think they might think of you less. You might think of certain things that some people, you know, you just don't feel comfortable. And so one of the biggest things for me is having a place where people can join together and actually connect and make something good out of something tragic. So with that, I used to spend a lot of time with my kids. You know, after their dad passed away, we were going on trips. We were going to California. We were going to like Africa zoos and all kinds of stuff, just so that I could feel like I was giving them what they were missing. But in all reality, there's no way that you can feel that empty void. That's something that has to be done internally. And so what I did is start working on myself. I started, you know, taking meditation retreats, and I started doing things that I felt were better for me, and in return, I was able to give a better me to other people. So with this, one of the biggest things I can say is use your grief, use your depression, use your sorrow to build something. Build something that's great. Build something that other people will be influenced by. Think of one thing that your loved one would enjoy for you to do and tie that into, you know, what you're doing for other people. One of the things that I do with the grief conferences is I really try to promote togetherness. I want other women to understand, and other people, I shouldn't keep saying women, I'm sorry, but other people to understand that at the end of the day, everybody goes through this, whether it's a family member or a friend or something. Eventually, every person on this earth is going to have to lose someone. And I'm trying to say that to sound unremorseful, because definitely I am. But I want you to understand that with that, that you can always turn something negative into something positive. One of the things that I've noticed with Miss Kamisha here is when she does her brunches, that she'll probably talk about in just a moment. When I went to the first one, I had no idea what it was for, how it was. But once I got there in a room full of women that were able to look at me and tell me that they had been through the same thing that I had been through, it was an eye-opener, because you just don't really realize how many women, men, children go through this same process every single day. I didn't even think of my kids at the time. I thought about me. Gosh, this happened to me. I didn't really think, you know, this happened to my kids. This happened to their family members. This happened to my sister. This happened to my brother. It was me in my bed, like, God, why would this happen to me? And so when I realized there were other women out there who were going through this, other children who were going through this, other men who were going through this, it was an eye-opener. So I just wanted to say, if you have something that you've been thinking about doing and you've been putting it off and it's going to benefit you, do it. It doesn't have to be a foundation. It doesn't have to be, you know, something where you're building, you know, to help other people. It can be something where you just do a self-enhancement to your, you know, where you're getting the attention and help that you need, counseling, you know, small meeting groups where you can get with other people and discuss things to help you see better. Even, you know, the HP Foundation. Ms. Misha is going to talk about that in just a moment, but being able to get with a group of people who can embrace where you've been and how you feel with that will help you. So with that being said, I would like her to talk a little bit about how she formed her brunches and everything, and I don't want to leave anything out, but how she was able to use that to build what she has currently going on.
Awesome. Yes, and I love speaking about my brunches, by the way, which is growing. So September 19th, around that day, time frame, around the third Sunday of September. However, the morning mimosa brunches, and I named it that for a purpose, morning mimosa. So not the daylight morning, but the morning that we go through after we lose a loved one. And mimosas, they're my favorite, but that's another story. However, Morning Mimosas Brunch, it was created as a support group and to introduce the new parents into, I don't want to call it an association, because it's really not even any association or club that anyone truly wants.
wants to be in. However, to have that support, to look around and see other parents who have lost children and to see how they're coping and how they're going through it. You'll hear people tell their stories of when they lost their loved one and how they're coping right there in their moment. And you'll see the different stages of the grief process and how everybody copes with it differently, like she said earlier. So we understand that, and we say, once again, one moment at a time, one second at a time, you have to be gentle with yourself. And that's what our Morning Mimosa Brunch actually speaks about. And then we just introduce people to our foundation in hopes that they can help support us and come to the events and get some support, because it really is about everyone coming together in that moment for that new person who lost that loved one. So that's pretty much the Morning Mimosa Brunch part of it. I can't say, all of our other programs are really, great too, but that is my pride and joy, because that's really how we help assist other parents by showing them the journey of other parents that have already lost their child.
Amazing. I love that.
And you have to go, because the food is good.
We try to get to the plate. We really like the community comes out. Shout out to Lolo's Chicken and Waffles. For 2 years straight, they, supported us by making donations of food and champagne. So we really love the support of the community. But it is what we do. We have, and you're not paying for anything if you're a grieving parent or if you lost a loved one. So if you guys have time, tentatively put it on your calendar, third Sunday in September, Morning Mimosa Brunch. That's my shameless plug. But yeah, so save the day, guys.
Oh, good. Okay. So also with this, what I want to say is I want to start doing larger conferences. I want it to be where we have a platform of women who have gone through this. So if you are a woman who has gone through this, a man who has gone through this, or a child who has gone through this, and you feel that you have a story to tell, I would love for you to email me at the Stacy Jewel Foundation at gmail.com, because we want to get more people together on the panel to be able to express. I don't like to show guests and I don't like to show visitors, because we don't know if in reality they want to be seen. Sometimes they want to just get help without anybody knowing. So we will never actually show the crowd, but we will always show our panel. Now, we definitely want people to reach out if they feel the need to be a part of that. So that's just there for you. And also, I will put it in the email below. And I'll also put the HP Foundation. What we want to say is, so they can write it down really quick.
The HP Foundation is the _HP_Foundation. And that's how you can find us on Instagram. You can inbox us, but absolutely reach out to either one of us, because I'm coming to the next one. She can't keep me out. She doesn't know, but she's sort of going to start this journey with me, especially she came to the very first Morning Mimosa Brunch.
Yes.
And it was a pleasure meeting her and having her. And I think this journey is going to be one that's needed and one that's a great communion of two foundations coming together to support the community.
And one way, in a sense, us doing our foundations has actually brought us together. Actually, her foundation brought me to her, because I didn't have mine first. I recently did mine about 2 years ago, but that actually brought us together. And it's an amazing feeling to have somebody that you can call or text and say, hey, what do you think about this? Or hey, I'm thinking of doing this. And it's like, you know what? I would enjoy that. So I think really getting out there and networking and meeting people is a blessing. So with that being said, I had a few questions that I wanted to ask. And what I wanted to do is, instead of kind of, I'm going to give you 3 cards here. And I have, I believe, 4 cards. And what we wanted to do is ask you, and we're going to ask each other, these questions. And then what we're going to do is ask for your input of what you feel would be beneficial to those that are maybe watching, that you can just type in what you've dealt with, how you use this to benefit and overcome certain situations. So it's a semi-game, but not really. It's more for information for everybody. So I will start. And the first question is, what
one thing that really stood out, we were going through his phone, and my son was really family-driven. It was a surprise to see, like, how he labeled some of his photos, family first, and all these different things. So that was a real pleasure to find. It really was. It made my heart smile in a really dark time. So,
that's good. And the reason why these questions are important is because sometimes people don't know what to do and how to react in certain situations. With her finding that out, I feel like it was an amazing thing because she could smile a little bit, like, oh my God, you know, I'm proud of my son for thinking this way, you know, and instead of thinking negatively about everything, sometimes you have to cope and think of something positive. So that was really good. Okay, so now you can ask me one.
Okay. Name one thing you felt guilty the most about after your loved one passed?
Honestly, so there's so many people I can mention, but I think the biggest one, which I'm going to try not to cry on this one because it's a newbie, when my sister passed away in March of last year, and we were in the room together by ourselves, I wanted to tell her how proud I was of her. Only because she probably thought that I did not think of her in that light. But she was an amazing mother. She did anything for her kids. She was very strong-minded, and she took care of them very well. And I, you know, at that moment, I wanted to say it, but I didn't want it to be a sad moment. So we joked and we laughed and we talked about other stuff. But in that moment, that was the only thing I think I would regret, is just not telling her how proud I was of her and how she handled it very well. She was very strong in the fact that she had cancer and she did not want people to look at her as a cancer patient. She wanted to be someone who was dedicated, and she was smiling, she was engaging. When she called me, she never talked about herself. She was like, how's that grandbaby of yours? So it was very emotional, but I didn't want to make it sad. So I didn't tell her anything, but I hope in her heart she knew that I was proud of her.
Yes.
Grandchildren, you know, different things like that sort of kind of really tug on my heart, where
It's not bad to think about those things. You're supposed to think about those things. So,
good. So, the question you have here, you guys bear with me because I don't have a glass.
One of the things I really wish people would stop saying is that time heals all things. And the only reason I say that is because, in a sense, I do believe that, but I don't think at certain moments it's appropriate. So, you know, when someone's leaving the cemetery, you know, on the day of a funeral, all time heals all things. Sometimes it's best to not say anything. Because, yes, we all know that, but in that moment, I don't really think that person is really hearing that. You know, just tell them you love them. Just tell them that, you know, you're grateful that they are there or something. But when you start telling them time goes all things, they start trying to think about how much time. Should it be 3 months? Should it be 6 months? Am I still grieving too long because it's been 3 years? Just let people grieve without giving them a time limit on it. I feel like time is, it will heal it, but let them do it in their own time. So I feel like that's one of the biggest things.
What the HP Foundation was started to do, to depressed or have anxiety?
Great question. I think for me, it's little things. Little things like a song I hear, or just going, like you said, being in the grocery store and seeing something. A lot of times, it is me in silence, where I'm thinking about something and I start reminiscing, and then the good reminiscing makes me feel bad because it's like, should I be happy? Should I be living the life that I wanted to live? Should I be doing this without these people? When their life stopped, you know, minding, but should I, is it okay to smile and laugh and do those things? So, really, oddly, sometimes the happy moments are the things that make me sad, because I feel like, why aren't they here to experience this? Why would they not get the chance to see this? Even, and the funny thing is, it's even movies. I can go to a movie and sit there and say, God, you know, well, the last time I seen this was with this person, or the last time I seen this was with that person, and then I think, they would have wanted to see this. This is a good movie, you know? So I have to literally every day try to deal with a way to get over depression, anxiety, grief. And it's not an easy task. Sometimes it's a very daunting task. And my attitude shows that those around me will definitely say, oh, she's in a good mood and they love that. But then when I'm in my mood, sometimes I just want to be left alone. And it could be just something simple like that. So if you do have those issues, if you are having that, one of the things that I do to get over it is to tell myself that I'm worthy. I'm worthy to be here. I'm worthy to smile. I'm worthy to appreciate the life that I have left. I don't know how long it may be, but at the end of the day, every day to me is a blessing, and I should be able to get up and be happy to be here. I shouldn't have to feel sad that someone else is not. I would want them to be here, but for me personally, I feel like I should be able to tell myself, you are going to have a great day, and not feel like I'm lying to myself. So,
it's okay, because here's the thing with that. They want you to know.
Right.
You have to remind yourself of
right.
that. They want you to
they
have
do.
A good day. Do you really think your loved one's going, nope, I want Stacy to have a horrible day?
Right.
I don't want her to be successful in life. Not at all. Just
right.
like the question that you asked me, they want to see you succeed. They
exactly.
want to see you make it to the other side. So absolutely.
Yeah.
And you get one at a time, 1 second at a
yes.
time. On purpose, get up and say, you know what? I'm gonna put a smile on my face today because I know my loved one. I know my son wants to see me smile every day because my son told me I have a pretty smile. So
and
I
you know,
and
you do.
I know people want me to get up every
right.
day and smile and have a great day. So that's really how I got through that too, because I remember I used to sit down and try to eat food, and my son loved my cooking. So if I would cook and sit down and eat, I would push my food away because I would say, how dare you sit here and have this meal? And I know my son would be like, Mom, would you cook? Like, and so I had to know that my son don't want me to sit here and not eat. As much as I love to eat, oh my gosh, I love to eat. But as much as I do, he would want me to eat. So I had to start purposely revamping the way I was thinking about this Greek thing. And that's really how I started.
Right. Oh, that's good, yeah. I honestly for you on that because it's weird that we have trained ourselves to be that way, to where we have to actually, in order to have a good thought or a good memory, we have to like be in a certain group or really tell ourselves, no, it's okay. So it is okay. It's okay to be happy, it's okay to get through life, it's okay to do different things. So okay, so my last question. The hardest thing about my grief right now is
not being where I want to be with the HP Foundation. And I know that sounds funny, but I say that because I feel like I'm letting my son down. Because I know that sounds weird, but because I've been a little lax, you know, but I've been dealing with a lot of stuff personally. And, you know, sometimes it gets a little hard to prioritize and have all these personal things going on over here. You have your business, you have work, and it's like all these things, and then some you know, but that would be that, especially in the light of, you know, his 9-year passing just a few days ago. Right. So I just remember laying in my bed, honestly. So all of this is fresh, and I have one of the logos up on the wall, and I just stared at it, and I told him, I'm turning the burner back up. It's coming to the front burner, and we about to turn up. We're going to turn it up. You see me here with the Stacy Jewel Foundation, sitting next to Stacy. Out of their mind, or they end up committing suicide. Like, I really believe that I was in that darkness. And if it wasn't for self meditating, getting into God's word, and just recentering me as an individual, I promise you, I think I would have slipped to the other side. So meditation, you guys, is very important. Taking that time to yourself, that's very important, because even if you take that moment to yourself and you sit there and all that love comes to you and it rolls down your face in tears, that is still you taking the time to reflect and allowing yourself to absorb the moment. So yes, it is very important.
It is. Well said.
Personally, what it means to me is giving.
did with your grief? We all know she started the HP Foundation. What would you say to other people that are grieving about how to get through that and what they can do if they don't want to create a foundation?
I would say, I'm going to piggyback on something we said earlier. Get yourself busy. Do a craft that you love. Go spend some time with some other loved ones. Just keep yourself moving as much as you possibly can and interacting with the world as much as you can, because I know during that brief, the beginning of brief breathing, that you want to sort of kind of keep to yourself and stay in the bed, like she said. And I get it. I'm just saying. So, but this would be my advice of me looking back and saying, okay, I could have done this because I could have tried to give myself the energy to get up. So I know how hard it is. So that's why I'm saying, if you can push yourself to do one thing that you don't feel like doing every day, just push yourself one thing that you really don't feel like doing, and that will sort of kind of help you along with the process and absorbing it a little better, because we can, everybody has that different time frame of how they absorb this. And I met a mother once, and it had been about 6 or 7 months, and that's still very fresh, but 6 or 7 months, and she was at her gravesite every day for 6 or 7 months, and she said, I know I'm obsessed with this, and I don't know how to get past it. Like, so I understand, like, we take these moments, but if we can allow ourselves, like, if she could have allowed herself, like, one day not to go, it would have been able to give her the strength to do it for 2 days. And not saying that she did it wrong at all, because everybody grieves differently. However, if we want to grieve healthy, we have to sort of allow ourselves to come out of that grief comfort zone, so to say, that we get stuck in. And I was stuck there too, so I'm just giving my little 2 cents of how I wish I could have
right.
Been a little different.
Exactly. And I agree. I was there too. I was there a lot at the cemetery a lot. And I would take a chair, a picnic basket, a blanket, and just be there. And one day, you know what really, and I'm glad you said that, because it just came to my mind, but one day I was there and the sun was going down. And I thought to myself, I wish I could spend the night here. And in my mind, I'm thinking, this is a cemetery, you know, and the fact that I'd be willing to stay somewhere and just be there all night long, I think that's when it hit me that I needed to get myself together, because I couldn't be there all day every day. I'm not dead. I was alive. I needed to be alive, and I needed to live my life. So I think that's a really good way of putting it. I don't think anybody's wrong for any way of how they handle it. I just think that with us going through it, it's easier for us to kind of give you kind of a way to deal with it, where you're not feeling bad about making those choices, because it's not bad. You don't have to go every day. I'm not saying it is bad if you do. I'm just saying you don't have to, so you don't have to feel bad about it. And so the last thing that we will cover is how we're going to help others now. So obviously we both have foundations, and we want to help people. My side of it is with counseling, with grief conferences, and with retreats. So I want to be able to provide people with the help that they need in order to self-grow, in order to build themselves up, and in order to be a prominent person that they can go out into the world and do what it is that they need to do. So then, Ms. Misha will tell you how she is.
And the HP Foundation, like I said earlier on, we help parents who recently lost children who did not have life insurance from the ages of about 1 to 21. We help them with the burial costs, so we sort of step in financially and start to ease that pain, so to say, because nothing is worse than losing your child and then not knowing how you're going to pay for this expense to lay them to rest. So we want to start that healing process financially right there, and then help them through the process, and then with partnering up with the Stacy Jewel Foundation and having that support of a resource to refer them to, so they can get that additional assistance if they need it, if they need the counseling, or if we need to go on a retreat because I'm heading up the retreat. So any of those things, that's where this community connection is very important, so we can complete that total healing process. And then on the back end of that, we help the community by just educating, free workshops. You come, you get a meal, you get get the 101s of basic life insurance, and then we refer you out to our different agents that work with our agency, different agencies that work with our foundation to get you that affordable life insurance. So these are the things that we're doing to help the community to sort of kind of cushion that healing process when it first starts, because you don't want to financially stress yourself out and then still be grieving the loss of your loved one. So that's sort of kind of what we do in a nutshell. So, and we hope that you make the next one, but that's how we help.
And that actually is so amazing, because you will not know how many people go without life insurance and their families are not only grieving, but now they're financially in strain. And that is like one of the biggest things that we hear all the time. So, you know, people, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, it's not better that they die if they need money, but it leaves you a way to take care of it without feeling that financial void. So, you know, that's definitely a reason, if not 100 reasons to come. So that's really good. All right, so the last thing that I wanted to do before I say goodbye is I'm actually going to give you one. I have the Get It Together Now, which is a motivational book. Basically, it is about personal growth. And you can get it on Barnes & Noble's, and you can get it at ajournalisticview.com, which is one of my blog and bookstore websites. But it is a way for you to read and to kind of ask yourself certain questions. It's a way for you to kind of indulge in yourself. It's a way for you to figure out what you've been missing and why you've been missing it. So like on chapter 7, just for example here, it says changing your mindset. How to think, how to talk, how to be in private, how to be in public. There's so many things you have to deal with without grief and depression on top of that. So if you get a chance to check it out, please do. And then just let me know what you think of it. But other than that, let's see. I'm going to see if we have any questions. I don't know if I can see them. Excuse me. Let's see if we have any questions
on here. We have waves. I don't know if it'll, let me see. So we're on two different platforms here. We're on Instagram and we are on Facebook, but I don't see anything, so I don't know.
So I don't wanna mess it up or show draws or anything. So we're just gonna say thank you all for joining us. We really appreciate it. And if you can, leave us some comments about how we did or any topics that you want us to answer, and we will definitely do that. And then please go on to our Instagram and Facebook and subscribe to the HP Foundation and the Stacy Jewel Foundation. And other than that, we wish you great success and happiness. Bye! Let's see if I can get it.
If I can get them to stop. All right, let's get
awesome
them there. In now. All right, so this
definitely
one I should want to
keep this energy going for sure.
Definitely.
Let me know.